Next set of questions. Provision for bad debts is made as per entity concept, conservatism concept, cost concept, going concern concept. What do we mean by provision for bad debts first of all? In balance sheet, we are having certain debtors at some value. But based on experience or by understanding the customer's position, we understand that out of these debtors, some debtors may fail, okay? And this failure may not happen immediately. I mean, as on balance sheet date, this failure has not materialized, but for all likeliness, it will happen next year and we may have to forego this debtor. It means that will be recognized as loss. So let us not give that shock to the customers, not the customers, the readers of the financial statements in the next year. Why? Because already we know, we have some idea that there are possibilities that certain customers will fail. Okay, so accounting concept says, especially the conservatism concept and prudence concept and all, it says if you are anticipating a loss, recognize for it immediately. Don't wait for that loss to happen. If you are anticipating, recognize it. And if it is not happening, then you can reverse it later. But if you are anticipating a loss, recognize it. Okay. So provision for bad debts is also something where you are anticipating a loss and you don't want to account for it only when it happens, because already you know that it is likely to happen. So you want to be very, very conservative when you prepare your financial statement. That is, you don't want to carry the debtors at inflated numbers, because for all likelihood this value will come down because of failure of some customers, which eventually we will write off as bad debts. Okay, so let us not give that shock to the readers of the financial statement when that event happens. So now itself will give them an indication, will reduce the profit now itself by creating provision for bad debts, and that is done as per conservatism concept. So the answer is B. Next, item 7, fixed assets and current assets are categorized as per concept of separate entity, going concern, consistency, time period. First of all, we should understand what are fixed assets, what are current assets. Fixed assets are those assets which are purchased with an intention to use in the business. There is no idea to sell. There is no idea to sell. It does not mean fixed assets are something which are going to be fixed and erected in one place. The intention is more important. It is purchased with an intention to use in the business and there is no idea to sell. It means they are going to help you in generating revenue or reducing cost, or it is going to help you for a longer period of time. And when we say longer period of time, it is greater than 12 months. So those are called as fixed assets. Whereas current assets are those which can be converted into cash within a period of 12 months. Okay, say for example your inventory, which you can sell and convert as cash within a period of 12 months. Your debtors, already you have sold, you can convert that as cash into within a period of 12 months. Okay, so fixed assets are something which are going to be with you, which are going to help you in running business for a period more than 12 months. It is going to give you benefit. It is going to give you future benefit for a period more than 12 months. Whereas current assets are something which you can convert into cash within a period of 12 months. So 12 months greater than up to 12 months. So the focus is on time period, right? So we can say fixed assets and current assets are categorized as per concept of time period, right? Next. Omission of paise and showing the round figures in financial statements is based on what concept? Is it conservatism concept, consistency concept, materiality concept, or realization concept? See, let's say the payment made is 12,50,250.26 paise. Okay, this is a substantial figure. Okay. And this is very, very small amount and it is not going to have any impact or a significant impact on the readers of financial statement. Any amount which is going to influence the decision making of the readers of the financial statement, we will call that as material amount. Whereas this decimal will not influence. Why? Because this is not material in nature. It is not big. This is not material in nature. Okay. So going by this, we can say omission of paise and showing the round figures in financial statements is based on materiality concept. Next, item 9. Income tax of the sole trader, not sale trader, sole trader paid is shown debited to P&L account, debited to trading account, debited to his capital account and none. See, income tax of whom? Sole proprietor is his personal expense. Okay. And that will reduce his capital only. This will reduce his capital. So, capital will come down because the profits are used by him for paying income tax. Okay, so we can say it will be debited to his capital account. When capital account is reducing, it will be debited. Right, next, item 10. Payment of salary is recorded by which entry? Debit salary, credit cash. Debit cash, credit salary. Debit employee account, credit cash. Debit employee account, credit salary account. See, salary, first of all, identify it is a nominal account. Salary is an expense. Debit all expenses. So salary account should be debited. And what is going out? Cash is going out. Cash comes under real account. Debit what comes in, credit what goes out. Cash is going out, so we'll credit to cash account. So salary account is debited, cash account is credited, and we have that here. Debit salary, credit cash account.